Dear Nintendo, oof. Where do I even start? I have no idea where to begin with you. I mean, I knew it would be bad, but I did not expect it to be this bad. This is so much worse than I imagined. I knew that giving a 10-year-old a wand that controls the weather would be potentially terrible, but I didn't know that it would be the most disastrous video game item that I've ever covered in my entire life. My God, this thing is freaking terrifying. Okay, deep breaths. We can do this. Just put it out of your mind, Austin. We can get through this just one step at a time. Hi, it's me, Austin, and I'm here once again to talk about the weather in one of the Zelda games because apparently something is utterly wrong with me. But, I mean, cut me some slack. What else am I gonna talk about when doing a video on Wind Waker? The science of fish who are also expert cartographers and the ethical implications of being a seaside town that is heavily dependent on fishing, killing, and eating a fully sentient species? God, this game is horrifying. Seriously, I think this should have won an award for being the most low-key horror game for the GameCube. I don't know why people were complaining on MySpace back in 2002 about the game not being the dark, grown-up Zelda title that they wanted. This game is terrifying anywhere you look, starting almost immediately out the gate with that frickin' kid that chases you around with snot dangling out of his nose. Get away from me! I don't want your boogers on me! Ah! That's just scary to me because I'm the parent of a toddler and I have a very intimate relationship with the tactile experience of human nasal mucus, and stuff like this just hits me way too close to home. But you're not here to listen to me wax philosophical about the tensile strength of snot. You're here to listen to me rip a beloved Zelda franchise apart with the awe-inspiring powers of science! So, let's get to it. How exactly does the Wind Waker work? And more specifically, how utterly disastrous is it? Okay, a summary for those of you who don't know, or a refresher for those of you who forgot, because this game originally came out, dear lord, 16 years ago. Meaning people born on the day of its release can legally drive in the United States now. Just great. First people born when Final Fantasy VII came out turned 18. Now this, and I feel frickin' old! As y'all probably know by now, there's three different parallel Zelda timelines that follow three different courses of events following Ocarina of Time. One where the player couldn't be bothered to beat the game, so Ganon won and Link was gutted like a fish. And two, where Link defeated Ganondorf during Ocarina of Time and Link was returned to being a child. And one where he continued to live as an adult. Wind Waker takes place in the third branch of this timeline, what's known as the adult era. In fact, in this branch, it's the game that takes place immediately after the events of Ocarina, more or less. Ganon comes back and there's no hero to stop him, so the king of Hyrule floods the entire country, turning it into a sea. Then, bafillions of years later, or just 100 or whatever, sometime after this, Ganon starts doing bad stuff in the newly created sea, so our reincarnated Link, a 10-year-old boy, is gifted with the Wind Waker as a tool to aid in his journey to stab Ganon to death again. The Wind Waker is capable of doing a crap ton of stuff, some of which is honestly pretty boring, like communicating with the sages, but then it can do even more serious things, like change the direction of the wind, create cyclones, and strangely change daytime into nighttime. Now, the last one seems like it would be perhaps the most disastrous of all three, since it would affect ecosystems all across the entire world, not just locally. Not to mention the possibility of flinging all occupants of the planet into the air and slamming them back down due to angular momentum, but it turns out that the cinematic for this particular ability actually begins and ends with a fade to black, meaning that we have no idea how long this process even takes from either Link's perspective or the perspective of everyone else in the world. For all we we know, he's just standing there slack-jawed like a jackass, staring into the middle distance like he's in a Bethesda RPG while people go about their affairs trying not to bump into him for hours. Or maybe the thing is filled with the same opiates that are in Big Boss's giant vape cigar, and Link is just getting super stoned while a high-pitched woman vocalizes behind him so it seems like time is passing faster. Anyway, this isn't that important because it's by far the least damaging thing this glorified weapon of mass destruction is capable of. The biggest problem, by far, is the ability it has to change wind directions. But in order to understand why that's so dangerous, we're gonna have to talk a little bit about how wind works. I talked a bit about this in my Breath of the Wild video, but wind exists essentially because of heat, specifically differences in the amount of heat energy across the entire planet. This is due to a variety of factors, but the biggest creator of wind is actually the sun. At any given moment, the sun is only heating about 50% of the planet. This difference in heat from only one side of the Earth getting sun creates differences in pressure, since hot air rises and expands while cold air sinks and condenses. When gases in the same container, in this case the container is the Earth, are different temperatures and under different pressures, they want to mix together until they're both the same pressure and same temperature. In thermodynamics, this is what's known as equilibrium. And since cold air is denser and under higher pressure, this means that in almost all circumstances, cold regions of air move into hotter regions of air. The existence of gravity and the rotation of the Earth complicate this somewhat, but it is a pretty good rule of thumb for those of y'all who are taking Meteorology 101, and we'll talk about how this affects things later on, but for now, keep this in mind. Air moves from high pressure to low pressure. So before we can draw any conclusions about the climate of Hyrule, we first have to figure out how fast the wind is even moving. Because if we can't figure that out, we're dead in the water. That was not intentional. Now, those of you who have watched my show know by now that in order to measure stuff in video games, we need to do pixel measurements. And in order to do pixel measurements, we need a ruler. And already you can see that we're gonna run into some problems in that A, each iteration of Link is a reincarnation of a past Link, and there's quite possibly a large variety of different heights they have, and B, the proportions of Wind Waker are just freaking goofy, man. I mean, I love this art style, but I can pretty much make no presumptions about anything being standard because this game is super, super cartoony. But then I remembered that there's one thing that appears in every Zelda title, one object that's immutable, one thing that's impervious to change because it's not a reincarnation of anything, but rather it's the same thing every single time. The Master Sword. This is a relic used by Link's going all the way back to Skyward Sword, and off the top of my head, there's not just one, but two games we could use to get this length. Breath of the Wild and Ocarina of Time. And as much as I'd love to jump into Breath of the Wild, considering that Wind Waker is closer to Ocarina of Time, both in the Zelda timeline, but also in our real-world release dates and therefore presents less margin for error based on the changing tastes of 3D modeling artists over time, that's the one I'm gonna use to get the length of the Master Sword. And in order to do that, we're gonna have to take a deep breath and use the pool in the Lakeside Laboratory plus the iron boots, which allows us to sink to the bottom and use the meter marks to determine Link's height, which is approximately 1.619 meters or just shy of 5 foot 4 inches, which we can use together with the Pythagorean theorem in order to reduce inaccuracies in our math due to pixel stretching in Photoshop to determine the length of the Master Sword, which is just shy of a meter at 99 centimeters or 3 1/4 feet. Knowing the length of the Master Sword, we can now hop back to Wind Waker, where we need to determine 10-year-old Link's height because measuring with the Master Sword would be really, really inefficient, which gives us a Link who is only 103 centimeters tall. Congrats on being in the 1/10th percentile for 10-year-olds. You'll grow up eventually, little buddy. Using this, we can determine his run speed, 4.35 meters per second, or just short of 10 miles an hour, which will allow us to measure a length of land and time how long it takes for the wind to travel that distance, which finally gives us a base wind speed of Wind Waker, which is 30 meters per second, which is 59 knots, or 68 miles per hour. But we're still not done yet, because in order to know everything we need to know about the pressure gradients, we're gonna have to know the size of the map, which we can get by measuring the speed of the King of Red Lions, which is 13 knots, 15 miles an hour, or 24 kilometers per hour, measuring how long it takes to traverse one distance of one side of one square of one grid of the map, which gives us a length of 434 meters, multiply that by 7 to account for one side of the whole map, and then square that number, which gives us a total area of 9.27 square kilometers! Woo! All right. No biggie, just blew through a week's worth of math in just under a minute. And heck, since you're here, if you were impressed by that epic display of math and breathlessness, why not subscribe to the Game Theorist channel for more? Hold on to your butts, because this still isn't enough information to get us where we need to go. Because in order to know exactly how dangerous this thing is, we have to know one more thing. The latitude of Hyrule. Latitude, for those of you who don't know, Good job, Austin. Latitude, for those of you who don't know, is the degrees north... Oh my god. Can't even f***ing say normal words now. Latitude, for those of you who don't know, is the degrees north or south of the equator something is. The further north or south, the more rotation there is in wind systems, the more extreme seasons are, and the colder and darker your winters get. You may think it's impossible to determine where the latitude of Hyrule is, but you would be wrong, because the constellation Ursa Minor, or the Little Dipper, is in Wind Waker, and we can use the Little Dipper, or more specifically, the star Polaris, to figure out our latitude, which we can use to figure out our pressure gradients and how they relate to wind speed. Polaris, also known as the North Star, is a star system approximately 433 light years away from Earth, and it aligns almost exactly with the North Pole, which is why it's been a consistent navigation star for, well, ages. It's only visible from the northern hemisphere, so we know that Hyrule is in the northern hemisphere already. Now, in order to figure out our latitude, we simply have to measure how many degrees above the horizon Polaris is, which is difficult without an actual astrolabe, but we can get pretty damn close using a combination of the in-game compass and the telescope, which gets us a latitude of 25.29 degrees, which places Hyrule just on the barrier between the tropics and the subtropics. Anyway, we finally have all the information we need to build our geostrophic wind chart of Hyrule. That's those cool maps with the lines in them that show the pressure gradients of different regions. In the subtropics at latitude 25, in order to maintain wind speeds of 60 knots, the air pressure has to drop by 1 millibar every 21 nautical miles. A millibar is 1/1000th of a bar, the standard atmospheric pressure at sea level in most areas. That's actually not that much of a change, all things considered. That's more or less the amount of pressure a quarter exerts on the ground due to gravity. That's how much the pressure changes over 21 nautical miles in order to maintain a 60 knot wind. Not too bad, right?
Wrong.
Interestingly, while air in the form of fronts move from high pressure to low pressure, wind actually moves perpendicular to the movement of pressure fronts. This is due to the Coriolis effect, the way fluid dynamics are affected by being on a rotating body. Winds, therefore, in the northern hemisphere, rotate clockwise around the high pressure systems. Meaning, if the wind is blowing from west to east, there's low pressure in the north and high pressure in the south. This is really important, because once you understand how wind works, you know that the Wind Waker is the most dangerous relic in the entire world. Air, like all non-photon matter, has mass. That's where the air pressure itself comes from, the weight of the air being pulled down on top of you by gravity. If it didn't have mass, there'd be no air pressure. Also, you already know this because I told you and you're a smarty pants that air moves due to pressure differences. Specifically, it moves perpendicular to the direction the pressure fronts move, clockwise around high pressure and parallel to the pressure gradient, which means in order for wind direction to change, air pressure has to move. And in Wind Waker, the wind speed changes direction in 3 seconds. I timed it. 3 seconds, which means if you're changing the wind speed from northeast to southwest, a giant pocket of air weighing 136 billion kilograms will be ripping across Hyrule at a terrifying 1,435 meters per second as it rushes to switch places with the low pressure front. This is over 4 times the speed of sound, so instead of a gentle breeze, it'd be like crashing into a brick wall in a jet fighter. Seriously, the force of air hitting Link alone is equal to the power output of a freaking train engine at full speed. This shockwave wouldn't gently move. It'd pulverize everything in its path. But Austin, I hear you saying, the high pressure system doesn't need to travel across Hyrule. It can just move around it, sparing the inhabitants death. Wrong! Ignoring the fact that this shows a tragic disregard for anybody unfortunate enough to live around Hyrule and not in it, and that taking this longer path to change wind directions would result in the pressure systems moving at Mach 6 instead of Mach 4 and essentially reduce the surrounding countries into steaming craters, Hyrule itself is still totally screwed due to one thing: eddies. Eddies are an effect in fluid dynamics caused by reverse flows, like, sudden wind changes over 120 knots at once. This sudden change of wind direction and speed would almost instantly spawn thousands of F1 to F2 tornadoes across the surface of Hyrule, tearing everyone apart at the seams because somebody couldn't be bothered to wait for the wind to change direction on its own. This stupid thing is so freaking dangerous! And not to mention that the pressure system required to maintain those wind speeds at peak would qualify as a Category 1 hurricane on the Saffir-Simpson scale. Hyrule should not be this tranquil. One wave of this stupid wand should reduce the entire country to a storm-ravaged ground zero similar to the red spot on Jupiter. But no, let's just hand it over to a 10-year-old. No big deal. Hey, Link, you want to save the freaking day? Break that stupid thing over your knee and go make yourself a sandwich. Sincerely, Austin.